Morning, brothers and sisters. Let us clap our hands and pray to the Lord. Father God, thank you for waking me up and for the gift of life. Lord, today I surrender every area of my mind, will, and emotions to you. I choose to dwell on your goodness and faithfulness so that the good seeds you have planted in my life will take root. Keep me close to you and direct my steps to the good path. Amen. Shout for joy to the Lord. All the earth worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Psalm 101-3.
Praise the Lord, his mercy is more, stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, his mercy. Omniscient, all-knowing, he counts not their sum. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more.
Is
We stood 'neath the debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. And all for us, you will lead the way. We have found a refuge, only you can say. Sing with joy now, our God is for us. The Father's love is a strong and mighty fortress. Praise your voice now, no love is greater. Who can stand against us if our God is for us? Even when I stumble, even when I fall, even when I turn back, still your love is sure. You will not abandon, you will not forsake. Cheer me on with a never-ending grace. Sing with joy now, our God is for us. The Father's love is a strong and mighty fortress. Raise your voice now, no love is greater. Who can stand against us if our God is for us?
To you, greetings in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Peace be with you and with your loved ones. We are continuing our series on Deuteronomy, and I will bring to you later the sermon for this week. But before that, we want to pray and stand in the gap. As usual, difficult times, grieving moments, especially for the family of God. And we know this week has been a very difficult week for a lot of us. We have lost our friends and colleagues, people who have been in the ministry for many years. We do not know why. We don't have all the answers. I don't have all the answers. And I believe that God is just telling each and every one of us to trust Him in spite of what we are going through. And so I just want to bring two items to the Lord, because we know that prayer is the only way that we can find rest, we can find refuge, because it's the only way we can express our grief and our request to the Lord. In fact, I like what Oxwell Sanders in his book on spiritual leadership about prayer and leadership. He says this: in prayer, we deal directly with God, and only in a secondary sense, other people. The goal of prayer is the ear of God. Prayer moves others through God's influence on them. It is not that the prayer that moves people, but the God to whom we pray. And so this morning, let us pray to the God that we trust, to the Lord Jesus Christ who have redeemed us, to whom we bring our requests. Friends, church, wherever you are in your various homes, would you also raise the voices to pray and seek God in this difficult time? I want to pray for two items, as I mentioned. I want to pray for the nation, as well as I want to pray for all of you, my dear brothers and sisters in Christ, wherever you are. I want to pray for your well-being. I want to ask God for protection over you, especially in this difficult time. I also want to ask God to bring favor in your life, bring relief if you are going through pain and sicknesses. God is our healer, Jehovah Rapha. Jesus is our healer, and he will bring healing and restoration. Let's trust him in this difficult time. Let's believe in him. And so as I lead you in prayer, come, let's commit this time to the Lord. Our Heavenly Father, we just come before you, your presence. We need you, Lord. We need you more than ever. Lord, we ask of your grace, your mercy for this time. Lord, we know that you are a merciful God, slow to anger, compassionate in every way. And so, Lord, this morning, our hearts cry out to you for our nation, Malaysia. Continue to pray that you will deliver us from this pandemic. We trust, Lord, that you are a gracious God. You have a purpose that you want to achieve and fulfill. And so, Father, we pray that you will relent in every aspect of your judgment over our nation. Lord, we pray for our authorities and we pray for our leaders. This is so difficult for them because they have not gone through this way before. They have not come this way before. This is an unprecedented time of and season that they are governing our nation. And so, Lord, we cry out for mercy for you, that you will intervene in this time. We pray for them. We pray for wisdom. We pray that you will govern our nation equitably, fairly, and justly. And so we commit our authorities to you, Lord, that they will phase out this lockdown slowly. And we know that we are moving into total inoculation over all our citizens and our people in this land. Lord, help us, Lord, in this process. Help us also to contain the new variant, the Delta and the Lambda that is fast appearing. It takes only 15 seconds to infect someone. Lord, have mercy upon our land. Have mercy upon us and the family. Lord, I want to pray for LHMC, the people here. My Lord, we pray that as we bring ourselves to you, I want to pray for each and every family here, Lord. Watch over them, protect them, guard them, especially in this time, the season, oh Lord, that we are going through, pain and suffering, and also, Lord, sicknesses, diseases that we go through. We ask, oh Lord, of your supernatural intervention in our life. We pray that, Lord, you will watch over us, the going in and the coming out, Lord. Guide us, protect us from this pandemic, Lord. Protect each and every families. We ask also for your favor for us, for our livelihood, especially the food on the table and the shell, the roof on our heads. Lord, we want to take this for granted and be presumptuous. But Lord, we ask for your grace and mercy. We thank you, we praise you that we get this opportunity to connect with one another, even through this online platform. What a grace and what a mercy that you, Lord, we experience in our life, even such a time like this. Lord, come, fill every homes with your blessings, with your favor and your protection. Lord, I pray and I plead the blood of Jesus over every homes, Lord, so that, Lord, we will attract your favor. We will stop and shun evil coming into our homes. So Jesus, you reign in our life, and we want to worship you and give you all honor and praise, even in this season. Lord, although, Lord, we go through difficulties, though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we do not fear any evil because your rod, your staff, they comfort us. So watch over us, O God, merciful God. We thank you, we bless you, we thank you for this day. This is a wonderful day that you have made in our life, and we want to bless you. We pray all these in Jesus' most precious name. Amen.
Almighty God, You have fulfilled your will to us by calling us your children. We humbly accept your precious gift, and in return, we offer our gift to you so that you use it for the expansion of your kingdom. Amen.
A very good morning to all of you, brothers and sisters in Christ. Shalom. Greetings to you once again. I trust that all of you are okay, doing well and healthy, and especially in this time of lockdown, and we are completely have to stay at home. I know that the EMCO has been lifted up in Selangor, and at least we could go out and do our walk. But pretty much so, the SOPs remain the same. I just want to ask you before I start this morning's message, continuing the series of Deuteronomy, the book of Deuteronomy. We are touching from chapters 16 onwards to chapter 18, the whole area of leadership. But before I go there, I just want to ask you, how are you doing it's very difficult on my part to engage with you, and it's difficult on my part to know you in a closer way, especially when we are in this situation where we are all in our various homes. But I just want to say that all of you are in my prayers daily, praying for you. I trust that you are doing okay. And so I would like to ask all of you, how are you doing? How are you really doing? Something that you also want to ask yourself, how are you doing spiritually, physically, mentally? And we all are in a very tense situation, especially if you are locked down in your homes and you have a lot of you staying. But we thank God we are from the middle and upper class people, not really in a very B40. And I trust that all of you are keeping okay. But I have got colleagues and friends who are at the B40. You know, some of them are having 6 to 7 people having to live in a very small apartment of less than 600 square feet. We can see how difficult it is. Nevertheless, we need to continue to uphold our nation in prayer, continue to provide comfort to those who are hurting around us. Just watch out. And I thank God for some of us here have gone out all the way to deliver food and items to people who are in need. Thank you for your hard work. I want to encourage all of you in LHMC, continue to serve one another, serve the people around us. Sometimes in spite of all these lockdown, we just have to look out and be sensitive to the needs around us. And so I want to thank you for all your support and prayers, as well as your encouragement. Continue to seek the Lord with all your heart. Our God will never fail you. He's good God. He's a good God. And so this morning, friends, let's turn to the book of Deuteronomy chapter 17, verses 14 to 20. This is just the few verses that I've picked, selected from the three chapters that we have supposed to read through. I cannot give you a sermon for the three chapters in a day, but I believe, as I pray, and I believe that this is something that God wants me to speak to all of you. It is on the area of leadership, the principles of leadership, a godly way. But let's read together. As you turn to the Bible, let's read Deuteronomy chapter 17, verses 14 to 20. I'm going to read to you from the NIV, the New International Version. When you enter the land the Lord your God is giving you, and have taken possession of it and settled in it, and you say, let us set a king over us like all the nations around us, be sure to appoint over you the king the Lord your God chooses. He must be from among your own brothers. Do not place a foreigner over you, one who is not a brother Israelite. The king, moreover, must not acquire great numbers of horses for himself, or make the people return to Egypt to get more of them. For the Lord has told you, you are not to go back that way again. He must not take many wives, or his heart will be led astray. He must not accumulate large amounts of silver and gold. When he takes the throne of his kingdom, he is to write for himself on a scroll a copy of this law, taken from that of the priests who are Levites. It is to be with him, and he is to read it all the days of his life, so that he may learn to revere the Lord his God and follow carefully all the words of this law and these decrees, and not consider himself better than his brothers, and turn from the law to the right or to the left. Then he and his descendants will reign a long time over his kingdom in Israel. This is the word of the Lord. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we pray that you give us an insight of your word. Your word that has preserved all these centuries for us, Lord. And help me, Lord Jesus, to bring clarity to your people. And help me, Lord Jesus, to deliver what you have instructed me to do so. And I thank you for this morning, for all of us. Help us, Lord, to live out your word in our lives so that others may be attracted to you and come to know the saving grace of yours. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Friends, let me just share with you some of the slides that I've prepared. I hope this will help you to follow with me this morning's sermon. Principles of leadership, the godly way. As I have really read to you just now, the scripture taken from Deuteronomy chapter 17, verses 14 to 20. Now we're talking about the leadership, the principles of leadership that we can learn from this book. When Moses gave the three discourses, his sermon to the people, the second generation of the people, they're just waiting to enter the promised land. As I told you before, that Moses' last book, in fact, with this book, he will end his life. The commentators have said that he didn't write the last few chapters of this book because by the time he has also passed on. And so this is a very important book as we want to read Moses' last word for the people. And so as we know that in everything rises and falls on leadership. Quote from John C. Maxwell, the leadership guru that we all know. And he is also himself a Christian, a born-again Christian. Everything rises and falls on leadership. God wanted Israel to have a structure of godly leadership. Israel is to only worship Yahweh. They are not told to worship any other gods. Because as they enter the promised land, they will experience and come to understanding of the people surrounding them. The nations surrounding them are worshiping all other gods. But they were told and warned that they only are to worship only Yahweh. And if they do that, that God will bless them and God will prosper them. But if they do not do that, God will bring judgment against them. So friends, Israel is to only worship Yahweh. Looking ahead, in fact, he even gave instructions for the time when they would have a king. You see, in this chapter that we read, that Moses is saying that one day you will need a king. You will ask for a king. This was not because God wanted them to have a king, but because he knew the future. He knew they would one day seek a king. Therefore, God laid out guidelines for choosing a king and also for the king's conduct after his coronation. You see, this is so vital and so important because here you are. God is laying down a foundation of godly principles, principles of leadership, principle where you expect the leaders of Israel to follow. And what God wants in a king, really, what God wants in a king, he wants a king to make sure that God's will, his will, is done among the people. And he wants to make sure that the king delivers the people from their enemies and to lead them in the right paths. God anticipates the time when his people would ask for a king. So as we go back into the book of Deuteronomy, as we look into this book, into these passages, God has already given a profile of the person who should be king among his people. Now, there are six distinct qualifications for leadership in the church. I would like to take this whole passage as we know that it is a qualification for the king. But I want to take these in bringing into the context, in hermeneutics, into the current time where we know that these principles are also applied right now for leadership in the church. So there are six distinct qualifications for leadership in the church. Firstly, the king must be anointed by God. So as we know that Deuteronomy chapter 17, verses 14 and 15 says, When you enter the land the Lord your God is giving you and have taken possession of it and settled in it, and you say, let's see, let us set a king over us, like all the nations around us. Be sure to appoint over you the king the Lord your God chooses. You see, what is the lesson of leadership here? Leadership is a calling. Leadership is a calling. If God did not approve the king, there was no hope whatever of him advancing God's purposes. Because if God doesn't approve it, if God says, no, I'm not approving this person, then that person cannot be a leader. Then that person cannot advance God's purpose in his life. There must be a mark. There must be the mark of God's presence in their lives. The people who is going to lead the people of Israel, the person who is going to lead the people of Israel must have God's presence in his life. There must be an evidential presence. This is a primary qualification of all godly leadership. There must be an anointing of God upon this person. This person must be filled with the Holy Spirit, and that's what is needed. A person that is chosen and a person that is being called by God to lead the people. And friends, that's important. Leadership lesson, number one lesson is leadership is a calling. So as we look through this whole passage, I will be showing you what is the principles and what is the lesson that we can do, a lesson of leadership. So one, the king must be anointed by God. The lesson is leadership is a calling. God is the one who calls a leader. God doesn't seem to have the same kind of qualification for leadership that we do. You see, if you look at a secular world, the calling of leadership is different. The calling to lead people in any businesses or in any secular world, you need the qualification and you need the experience. But in the kind of when God calls you, sometimes the only qualification is God calls you and chooses you to do it. And so, friend, when God told the prophet Samuel to find the next king, remember in Samuel, 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 6 to 7, God says to Samuel, go to the place, go to the home of Jesse. Go to the house of Jesse from Bethlehem and go there and look for a king. So when the verses 6 and 7 says here, when they arrived, Samuel took one look at Eliab and thought, you know, Eliab was the eldest in the house of Jesse. He says, surely this is the Lord's anointed. But the Lord said to Samuel, don't judge by his appearance or height, for I have rejected him. You see, friends, the Lord doesn't see things the way you and I see people. People judge by outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. I repeat, people judge by outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. God doesn't look on a person's physical appearance. He doesn't choose a person because they are big, strong, and handsome. God looks on a person's heart. God doesn't even seem to require that people be extra intelligent to be used. In fact, Paul wrote to the Corinthians, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 27. He says here, but God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. You see, that is how God chose. When God calls a person, it doesn't have to be the kind of people that we could imagine. The world will then want to pick such people as a leader. But no, God chooses people by looking into the heart of the person. And so, friends, lesson number one, leadership is a calling. Whom does God choose? All things, these things, whom does God choose? Humble, and those who are humble and have reverence for God's word. In fact, Robert Morrison of China wrote, the great fault, I think, in our missions is that no one likes to be second. So God chooses a person who is humble, who's a person who walks in humility and have a reverence for his word. Because when a person who has got reverence for God's word, he is always a humble person. A person who fears the Lord is always a humble person. A person who fears and shun evil is a person who is always humble before the Lord, before the people. And so, friends, whom does God choose? God chose the the weak, the not so strong, the not so clever, but who walks in humility and fear the Lord, because God sees the heart of that person. And that is what is important. Secondly, not only that the king must be anointed by God, but the king must belong to God's people. So the king must belong to God's people. Deuteronomy chapter 17, verse 15. It says here, he must be from among your own brothers. Do not place a foreigner over you, one who is not a brother Israelite. The church is not to depend on the sponsorship of famous names. It is to find its resources, her resources, from within the body of believers. And so, friends, when we pray for our church building fund, we must trust God. The resources are from within the body of believers. We believe God will move our hearts. We believe the God of the universe will move the hearts of our brothers and sisters in Christ, of fellow believers, and that we will be able to move and sow in faith and trust God. Friends, we need to believe and trust God by faith, trusting in him that he's a God that provides for all our needs. And so God's people should look for leaders who have proved themselves in the local church. So lesson is, leadership must come from within. For the nation of Israel, it meant that their king must be an Israelite, that the king cannot come from another nation. They cannot bring an immigrant. They cannot find a foreigner and then put that person as a leader, as a king. They couldn't post a help wanted. They cannot advertise the vacancy of a king to the neighboring country. They're not supposed to do all that. And when they needed a king, the king must be from their own people. So for the church, this may seem obvious, but for God's leader must be from the family. God's leader must be a Christian. Friends, we must always remember that leadership must come from within. That's why I always want to raise up leadership within our own community. It's time that we disciple one another, just like the way Jesus discipled his disciples. And out of that 12 people, in fact, was 11. And then later on, they brought in another person, 12. And out of that disciple, it grew. Out of the 12 disciples, it grew. And the movements continue to grow even to today. And we know that this is because of the work of the Holy Spirit. And I believe that we have to bring leadership within. And we have to find leaders and train them and mentor them and disciple them. And God will move mightily, powerfully. And this is what God wants us to do. So the king, firstly, must be anointed by God. Secondly, the king must belong to God's people. And thirdly, friend, the king must exercise faith. That's very important. The king must exercise faith. Verse 16 says, the king, moreover, must not acquire great numbers of horses for himself or make the people return to Egypt to get more of them. Chariots and horses were the key to Egypt's military power. In those days, in the time of Egypt, when Egypt was in superpower, one of the superpowers, chariots and horses were the key to Egypt's military power. And we all know that Egypt was the superpower then. Israel had never enjoyed this kind of resources. In fact, Israel didn't have all these resources. They actually, the people who fought on their food, they were farmers. They were actually cultivators of land. They didn't have any military might or power. In fact, all their victories was given to them by God. Their victories had been given by God because God was fighting for them. And the battle belongs to the Lord. They were just worshiping the Lord. They were just trusting God. In fact, there were people who were even lack of faith. They didn't even know. At times, because of God's mercy and God's compassion to the people, they won all the battles. And so, friends, here you are. You see, leadership. The king must exercise faith. A great leader doesn't trust in his own power. He trusts on the power of God. He trusts that the Holy Spirit will empower him, and he believes in the work of the Holy Spirit. So now God was telling the people, he was telling the people of Israel, if you have a king, then I do not want him to build personal security by making alliances with my enemies. You see, in those days, when you get yourself, acquire yourself great number of horses, is one way is to make alliance, make alliances with the people, make treaties with one another, make treaties with the neighboring countries and nations. So the king here is to model faith. God says the king must model faith. He is to put his trust in the living God. When the church appointed the first deacons, they chose Stephen, right? In Acts chapter 6, verse 5, because he was a man full of faith, a man full of faith. So where are we? Are we a leader, or are we a people of full of faith, or are we a people of half of faith or quarter of faith? Faith can be measured in whether you are in fullness of faith or half or quarter. It all depends on how much you trust Jesus, how much you trust our God. A great leader doesn't trust in his own power. And King David understood this. And that's why in Psalm chapter 20, verse 7, he says, some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we will remember the name of the Lord, our God. Don't misunderstand. Okay, don't misunderstand. David had a large army when he was a king. But he wasn't counting on his army to deliver him. No, friends, he was not counting on the army. He was not counting on his resources. He was just counting on God. He was counting on God even as a young boy, a young man. David knew he could face Goliath because God was strong. Nothing to do with David's weapon, nothing to do with him. He just knew in his heart of heart that he trusted God. God of Israel, God of the universe, would deliver him from the hands of Goliath. And even here in his battle with so many nations around him, he trusted God in his battle, and God delivered him. And so, friends, the king must exercise faith. Leadership among God's people must always be in the hands of people who know how to trust in the living God. A great leader must go forward. I'll just give you an example, an illustration. Panting and perspiring, two men on a tandem bicycle at last got to the top of a steep hill. That was a steep climb, said the first man. You know, when you're on a tandem bicycle, one fella in front and one fella at the back, cycling, okay? And the first man says, you know, that was a steep climb, very difficult climb. It certainly was, replied the second man. And if I hadn't kept the brake on, we would have slid backward. It's a joke, right? It's funny, right? One person cycling so hard, frantically trying to reach the hill, the hilltop. The other person is actually pulling on the brakes, thinking that if he doesn't do that, if he doesn't put on to the brake, the bicycle will go backwards. But friends, what we need here is a great leader must go forward. We cannot hold back. We cannot hold back, but must move forward. And so the king not only must exercise faith, fourthly, the king must be loyal. The lesson here is a great leader remains loyal and faithful to God. In the Old Testament times, it was common for kings to seal alliances with marriages. And that's why, if you know that King Solomon had many wives, okay, and many wives and many concubines, and yet, and why, how does he have these many wives? Because he seals alliances with marriages, okay? When every time every nation comes about, he marries them. When he marries them, he actually seals alliances. And those days, that's how people in the time of Moses, in the time of Old Testament, that's how they seal alliances through marriages. And when they get married to one another, And they keep within the clan their resources, their properties, their land. So it doesn't go to the another tribe or another nation. So by keeping them together, they always keep alliances. And by that, sometimes all these foreign wives will lead the king astray. And so this is what God wants. King must be loyal. The lesson is a great leader remains loyal and faithful to God. Today, a Christian leader's loyalty to God will be expressed in his loyalty to his wife. It's very important. A king must remain loyal. Fifthly, the king must be ready for sacrifice. Friends, the king must be ready for sacrifice. He must not accumulate large amounts of silver and gold. Kings in the ancient world had the opportunity to make a pile of money. But God said that the one who is given leadership responsibility over his people must not use his privileged position to feather his own nest. You see, friends, he must not be greedy, but must use his power for the benefit of the people. A great leader doesn't seek wealth. This is so in contrast to the secular leader that we always look at. You know, in a secular leader, he always wants to make money. When he makes money, that he feels that the power and the wealth brings him to the top of the ladder. Unfortunately, this is so different in a godly leadership. And a godly leader doesn't seek wealth. What he seeks is the glory and the satisfaction of the master's face. At the end of it all, he feels happy and enjoy the satisfaction that he brings to the face of the Lord, of his Lord, of his Savior. And friends, that is the sacrifice that he has to make, because when he makes the sacrifice, he knows that this brings joy and pleases the heart of this master. And so he must not be greedy. He must use his power for the benefit of the people. And so, friends, not only that the king must be ready for sacrifice, the king must know the scriptures. The king must know the scriptures. When he takes the throne of his kingdom, he is to write for himself on a scroll a copy of this law taken from that of the priests who are Levites. It is to be with him, and he is to read it all the days of his life, so that he may learn to revere the Lord his God and follow carefully all the words of this law and these decrees. Deuteronomy chapter 17, verses 18 and 19. This is marvelous, my friend. This is marvelous. The king was to make a handwritten copy of the law for himself. You see, when he is appointed, when he was coronated as the king, first thing what he must do is he must write for himself on a scroll a copy of this law taken from that priest or who are Levites. It is for him. It is a personal Bible that he is a handwritten personal word of God that he keeps it. So this is marvelous. What is the lesson? Make God's word your own. Leadership is to be given into the hands of people who know the word of God and will lead the people in it. Just want to give you my own personal testimony. When I came to know the Lord many, many years ago, when I was the age of 19 years old, in my early days of being a Christian, I used to write down scriptures because, you see, I find it so difficult to read them in the Bible and I just cannot understand. I cannot remember. So one of the easiest way for me is to write it down. And as I write down scriptures, verses into small notebooks, I carry it along with them. I put it in my pockets. I sometimes put it in my bag. I take it with me everywhere I go. And at times when I feel discouraged, when at times I feel I'm going through difficult moments in my life, when I feel scared, when I feel fearful, when I'm going through pain and suffering, I take these words out. I take the notebooks out and I read them. And I try to memorize them. When I do that, my friends, I feel there's a surge of faith that comes into my heart and into my spirit, man. that lifts me up from any despair, any form of pain, any form of fear. It's just dispelled. And all these will just go away. In fact, the word of God brings liberation. It brings deliverance. It brings healing, brings power, brings authority. And so later on, as I found out that navigators used to sell small cuts, you know, hundreds of cuts of verses. And so I bought them, and I keep those cuts with me. It keeps it in my car. I bring it along with me wherever I go. And wherever I feel that I need to, I just open up the cuts and I look at the cuts and I read those verses. And I really find peace and I find assurance. So make God's word your own. This is my comfort in Psalm 119, verse 15. It says here, this is my comfort in my affliction, that your word, O Lord, has revived me. Truly, friends, the king must know the scriptures. Every godly leader must know God's word. You must make God's word your own. And so let me just recap. There are six distinct qualifications for leadership in the church. First, the king must be anointed by God. What is the lesson? The lesson is leadership is a calling. Second, the king must belong to God's people. What is the lesson? The lesson is the leadership must come from within. Third, the king must exercise faith. A great leader doesn't trust in his own power. He trusts in the power of the living God. He put his trust, complete trust in Jesus. No matter how difficult situation may be, how times can be hard-pressed everywhere, but he never failed to put his trust in the living word and in God, and in Jesus Christ. Thirdly, that was the third one. Now, fourthly, the king must be loyal. What is the lesson? A great leader remains loyal and faithful to God. Why? Because God is faithful. God was faithful before. God is faithful today and God will be faithful tomorrow. And therefore, we are called to remain faithful to him because he has called us to be faithful and he's a faithful God. Fifthly, the king must be ready for sacrifice. Lesson, a great leader doesn't seek wealth. His wealth is in the joy of knowing his master is pleased with his work. It is so different from the world. Herein lies spiritual leadership. Spiritual leader is a leader who doesn't seek wealth. In fact, he give it all. He sacrifice everything because all that he wants is to please the master. All that he wants is to bring the glory of God into wherever he goes. Sixthly, the king must know the scripture. So therefore, make God's word your own. So let me end this morning. The conclusion of the matter. The king must model obedience to God. Verse 20. The king must not consider himself better than his brothers and turn from the law to the right or to the left. Verse 20. The king could not say to the people, do as I say, not as I do. But the world will say that. The world will say, do as I say. I don't need to follow what I do. Okay? Just do what I say. The most powerful man in the land must be the first to model commitment to the law of God. Friends, that's very important. Christian leadership is to model after Jesus' obedience to the Father. Look at Jesus. As we look at Jesus, he modeled to others how to live a life worthy of God's calling. We are called to be people of God. We are called to obey him. And it is so important as a leader, you are one of the most important principles of Christian leadership is to obey and model of the Jesus' obedience to the Father. Jesus lived a life of obedience, a 100% obedience to the Father. He obeyed the Father and did what was asked by the Father, even obeyed to death. Friends, as we look to Jesus, we look to Jesus not in our strength, but we look to Jesus in our weakness. We look to Jesus in our pain. We look to Jesus in our suffering. You know why? Jesus have gone through the same pain, the same suffering. In fact, his pain is even greater. He did not commit any sin. He is sinless, the sinless one that have gone through pain and suffering for us. And so what more, friends? When we go through pains and suffering and difficulties, we can look to Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. And so let us follow Jesus, obey him, guard our hearts thoroughly so that we will not fall off or fall away to the world. And I like to end this with a quote from Apostle Paul. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Let us bow down our heads. And let me pray for all of us as we end this morning sermon. Lord Jesus, we just come before you this morning. We bow down to you, Lord. We give you our highest praise and adoration. Forgive us, Lord, for not keeping to your word, for disobeying you in many ways. Sometimes we disobey you blatantly. We disobey you subtly. Sometimes we compromise in our behavior. We fail you in many areas, Lord. We truly repent before you. Forgive us, Lord, for sometimes our intention is not right. We do things to please our own self. We do things to benefit our own life and our family. Lord, we ask of your forgiveness. Lord, if you want us to be a leader, you will call us to be where we are. And we pray, Lord, even this morning, grant us humility in our way of walk, in a way we lead people, in a way we direct people. Grant us humility. Grant us, Lord, obedience to your word. Grant us, Lord, faith to trust you when the going gets tough. Because we know that the finest steel comes out from the hottest fire, and the interval of banging onto the steel, Lord, and the steel becomes stronger. We go through lives with pain, suffering. But Lord, we pray that as we obey you, Jesus, we will find the peace, the comfort, and the joy that pleases your heart as we lead your people, as we humbly follow your direction. And I pray for all of us here in LHMC, Lord, we will follow you, the great shepherd of all shepherds. Because when we look to you, Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, you will lead us to green pasture. You will lead us to quiet waters. You will deliver us from the evil ones. At the end, Lord, we can say, I shall not be in want. And so, Lord, this morning, I pray and ask of your favor for all of us here in LHMC. Let us be the doer of your word, active, obedient to your word, not in passivity, but complete obedience, trusting you all the way, moving forward all the way in this unprecedented time. Lord, we trust in you. We trust in your unfailing hands. We pray and we commit ourselves to you. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen. Amen. Now we have come to the end of our celebration. Let me give you the benediction. Dearly beloved, the God of peace will lead you. The God of comfort will comfort you. And the God of even healing will heal you. Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself, God our Father, loved us and gave us eternal comfort, good hope, grace, comfort your heart, establish them every good word.